Friends, welcome to this little introduction to defamation law in Australia. Defamation is a cause of action, that is, a basis for suing a person in a court. And defamation is a tort, which means wrong in French. In our legal tradition, it means defamation is a type of civil wrong, like negligence, and it's a basis to hold someone else responsible at law for something they've done wrong to you. The interest protected by a defamation is reputation. That is, defamation protects what people think of a person, what society in general think of a person. Where a person's reputation is damaged due to the conduct of some other person, well, the person who's had their reputation damaged may be able to sue that other person if certain criteria are satisfied. You can think of these as elements of the cause of action. Let's go through each of these elements. First, something needs to be published. Second, the published matter needs to be defamatory, and the key there being the adjective defamatory. Third, the defamatory publication must identify the defamed person. And fourth, pursuant to recent law reform that's now enforced through much of Australia, the defamatory publication must cause serious harm to the defamed person or be likely to cause serious harm to the defamed person. Now let's step through each of those elements in turn. Publication means that the matter, whether it be a website or a tweet, a Facebook post or a speech in a public forum, it needs to be communicated to a person other than the person whose reputation is being messed around with. This means that there are at least three persons involved in any case of defamation. There's the publisher, the person who says the thing or writes the thing or communicates the thing. There's the person defamed whose reputation is harmed. And then there is the audience or the recipient of the publication. It'll be at least one person who's not one of the other two, and it could be a great many people. Publication is not the same thing as authorship. This can have interesting and even unexpected consequences where digital media is involved. In a given case, you may have lots of publishers, each having published the same content, the same defamatory matter, each being a potential person who the defamed person can sue. There are a few different tests for what is defamatory. The common thread between these tests is that the defamatory matter has injured a person's reputation in some way. This means that it has caused people to think less of that person. In order to determine whether or not something is defamatory, the law applies a test called the ordinary reasonable person. What would the ordinary reasonable person think of this publication? The answer to that question, according to our law anyway, is a question of fact. Whether or not someone has been defamed is a factual question. And so in certain cases in Australian courts, juries still determine whether or not someone has actually been defamed. But importantly, in the Federal Court of Australia, you're very unlikely to see a jury. So in that court, and in many other cases, it'll be a judge and not the jury who decides whether or not someone has actually been defamed. That is, it's the judge in many cases who decides what the ordinary reasonable person would think of the plaintiff. Identification is an easy element. You don't need to be identified explicitly in order to be defamed. For example, identification can come indirectly by reference to title or a person's situation, or even through innuendo. And as for serious harm, this is a new law. It's inspired by some 2013 reforms to UK law. But exactly what serious harm means in the context of Australian defamation law is a question that will be grappled with by Australian courts over coming months and years. The law seems to be intended to keep more trivial matters out of court. So, for example, backyard claims, they're sometimes called, where neighbours are having a go at each other, maybe they won't overcome the serious harm threshold. Whether or not this turns out to be the case remains to be seen. So those are the elements of defamation. If a person succeeds in suing and proving those elements, then that plaintiff may be entitled to a remedy. The traditional remedy for defamation is damages, which is a sum of money that the loser, the defendant, will pay to the winner. In unusual cases, a plaintiff may also obtain an injunction, which would restrain the defendant from repeating the gist of the defamatory publication. As you can appreciate, the recognition of defamation in Australian law has a negative impact on freedom of expression. Freedom of speech in Australia isn't as free as it is in certain other jurisdictions like the United States. But Australian law does recognise that freedom of speech is valuable, and so there are various defences which may protect a person from liability for saying something that would otherwise be defamatory in various circumstances. There are lots of different defences to defamation. Some of them are quite technical, so here's a quick overview of some important ones. Justification, often known as the truth defence, arises where the defamatory stings were substantially true. The burden of proving truth falls on the person who made the comment, the publisher, and this can be quite difficult to overcome. Innocent dissemination protects publishers of defamatory matter who weren't aware that they even published something. This can have an important role when you're dealing with digital communications, and say, for example, someone makes a comment in response to something you posted online. You may not even be aware of the comment, or you still might be a publisher, but the innocent dissemination defense may protect you. Absolute privilege protects certain publications that are made in an important setting. An example is a witness giving evidence in court, which points the finger at someone. Well, that would otherwise be defamatory, but if you do so, you're not going to win. A similar principle applies to proceedings of parliament. So if your local MP says something defamatory on the floor of the Legislative Assembly or the House of Representatives, you won't be able to sue over it, at least not just in respect of what was said in that room. Qualified privilege is a tricky but important defence. At common law, qualified privilege protects individuals who have a duty, whether it's social or moral or legal, to make some sort of statement. And the person who is on the receiving end of that statement has an interest in receiving it. A classic example might be a report to the police or a report to an employer of a colleague's misconduct in the workplace. There have been different statutory versions of this common law qualified privilege defence. They vary between jurisdictions. In Australia, we also have a modified qualified privilege defence, which purports to give to effect to the implied freedom of political communication in the Constitution. It's called longing qualified privilege. The case law has shown that this defence has been quite toothless. In recent months, a new public interest defence has come into force through much of Australia. The defence protects defamatory publications made where the matter in question is in the public interest, and the publisher reasonably believed that making the publication was in the public interest. The idea is that this new defence will better protect things like investigative journalism, where someone's reputation may be injured in the course of reporting, but doing so may serve some greater public good. There's so much more detail to Australian defamation law than that I've covered here. Ideally, if you want to get around it, you'll read a good book on point, like Rolfe on Defamation Law, rather than just Googling. Of course, if you're not a legal practitioner, you should go seek the advice of a lawyer. And on that note, feel free to hit me up on LinkedIn if you need advice. Thanks.